was dying actually to go to the loo back there. I really was.
And
I kept thinking, I'll miss a bit, you know, I'll miss a bit that's really important. And they said to me, go on, you must stand by. And I was glued to it watching.
What about, I'd like to ask all of you actually about critics.
I loathe them, and I've got a record of saying how much I loathe them so many times, it's almost become commonplace, you know, I regard them as.
But Kenneth,
I've always said they're the eunuchs in the harem, you know, they're there every night, they see it done every night, but they can't do it themselves. Useless, you see, and there's a marvelous.
But they're not always, Ken, because always there's a grain of truth. That's what's so unnerving.
Hardly ever, and even if there were, Maggie, I would say this. They might, in what they say, be saying something true, but they've hardly ever earned the right to say it. You see, that's the point.
Yes,
that's the real point. You see, people like these sort of, you know, would-be doyens. They write in Sunday newspapers and look upon themselves as sort of, you know, augurs of what's good taste and what's bad taste. They sit there as though from Olympian heights, you know, discussing other people's work and often damning them in the process. I could show you cuttings that name people as being the best, you know, one of the critics said, not only the best in the Western Hemisphere, nay, the world. And went on to name people that have trod a path into oblivion. I've not heard of them ever since, you know. And so you begin to think, well, what are they worth? They're all useless, you see.
Yes.
Because half the time, they're not really doing what a critic should do, that is communicate some sort of affection and love for his subject to the reader. They're really not doing that. What they're really doing is turning a fashionable phrase that might make them well-known, them a reputation, you know what I mean?
I don't honestly think you can lump them all together, because there are, you know, there are some serious ones.
I mean,
and you can learn things,
basically,
sometimes change.
You would say that they're to put it crudely, pleasuring themselves rather than
well, the poor things, they've got a rotten job, obviously. I mean, it's a rotten job. I admit that. It's a very frustrating job. I know a lot of them are sort of, what is it, short? A lot of them were frustrated playwrights or something. A lot of them frustrated actors, probably. But, you know, Russell Lovell said that there's something fundamentally ridiculous about criticism insofar as what is good without us saying so.
Yes, yes.
You know what I mean?
Yes,
and that, I suppose, really exposes the whole thing.
And it also brings out the truth of what you said, that the communicating enthusiasm
precisely
is what you should do.
That's what they should be doing. Now, there are certain people that can do it. Mm-hmm. There are. I mean, I've read Rex Reed, you know, there's profiles in New Yorker, and he really does communicate an atmosphere. You do feel, if you're reading that kind of writer, you do feel something of the atmosphere of the show, the entertainment he enjoyed, and he infects you. And this really happens with good teaching, doesn't it? A good teacher. He takes you into the realm of English literature, poetry. I mean, my English teacher did. He infected me with the spirit of poetry, you know what I mean? And he introduced me to poets, mostly, I must admit, the Romantics. Probably that was my melancholic leaning at the time. Shelley, Keats, Byron, these sort of people. And I've lived with them ever since. I've enjoyed them because he infected me with them. But he didn't do it in any way destructively. Do you see what I mean?
Exactly.
He did it with love and affection. And I'm sure that the real, you know, the criticism that matters in this sense is that kind of thing, not the thing where they're turning a nice phrase, which is a good headline, or something clever, or something catty, or something malignant, which lingers in the memory for a day or so. And it's certainly only for a day or so.
Do you get really melancholic about...
I don't belong to a press-cutting agency. There was a time when I longed to see my name in print. Now I see it with dread.
And does it really affect you?
Oh, I always believe it's true. I believe anything that's said against me is true. And anything that's said in my favour is flattery.
Really?
Yes, I never can believe that I'm any good at all.
No, I think all artists desperately need the reassurance from the outside of their own worth. They haven't got it within.
Yes.
I think this is one of the paradoxes of all art, don't you? I mean, that though they may appear very often, artists, to be people of power and strength, in actual fact, the reverse is true. They're the most vulnerable people in the world.
Yes.
I remember going backstage and meeting my idol at the time, Sir Godfrey Toe.
Yes.
And he actually said to me, and he was giving a marvellous performance in the air, it's the Haymarket, and I was sitting in his dressing room, I was full of awe, I was a very young actor, and very green, and I couldn't even find words to say how marvellous I thought his performance was. And he said to me, I've been terribly downcast because a woman brought her little boy to see it, he was 10, and he said, my trousers were too high and the socks were showing. And that worried him.
Kenneth and Maggie, can we talk a little bit now? We've been talking a bit about show business, about something that Sir John was talking about earlier, about the whole business of preservation and this sort of thing. Is it something that, that concerns you too? I mean, are you basically on Sir John's side on what he says about this?
Hmm? Yes, I am. I see the problem another way, because I have two brothers and they're both architects, and they say, but if we go on keeping things standing, what else can we build? I suppose really our problem here is that we are just a small island.
Mm. But the examples of planning light that you do see, things like the dreadfulness of the Elephant and Castle, which used to be a place of humanity and warmth and people, which is now just a concrete desert and a mess and an absolute disgrace.
Yes.
And what they've turned the Euston Centre into is the same thing, just a blight.
Frightful.
This sort of thing is really an absolute disgrace. Moreover, any government, any government, and it was the Labour government, I believe, which had the power, could have turned the whole thing into flats for people, left the whole thing standing empty all the time. It was a national scandal, did nothing about it at all. The Office Development Permit, it wasn't introduced by who was the man, the Lord, you know, the man that was Foreign Secretary. Who was he under the Labour government administration? George Brown.
George Brown.
Yes, he introduced the office development prohibition, you know. He stopped offices being built, but only in the last 2 years of the government, when it should have been done miles before. Yes. The first act of a socialist government, a government which says it's socialist, the first act they should make, is to stop all that and say, homes. Homes, the most important thing. Makes me sick when I read all this crap about, oh, let's have a youth club, let's have a theatre built, or let's have something else built. No good all that. Cultural activities are no good if there's no home to go to, is it?
Absolutely true.
Must have a home. Yes. So the first requisite is
possible on the ground.
Well, I was going to say... Yes.
It really makes me very angry. Doesn't it, you, to pass a great thing empty, a great skyscraper empty?
Right. I think
it's an absolute scandal. And yet they can all get worked up over a couple of pounds in their pay packet or something and go on strike. I mean, if unions really care, if they're really socialistic and say we care about our fellow man, why can't they march about something like that? Instead of another pound themselves, why not a few pounds for somebody else who's really hard up?
But that's not the union's problem.
It's not the union's fault.
Look, what is the statue outside the TUC? Have you looked at that statue? The statue outside the TUC depicts a man helping, doesn't it? He's helping up another man who is on the ground.
Yes.
And that statue symbolizes what the TUC stands for, doesn't it?
Of course.
Right, well, when a union does something like jeopardizing the work of their fellow men, if you stop trains, people can't get to their work, can they? Can they? They can't get to work, even. So in doing what you want for yourself, you're jeopardizing your fellow men, aren't you?
Yes.
Well, why can't you act in concert with your fellow men? Why do you have to do something which endangers the livelihood of your fellow men? When that statue represents exactly that, helping, hindering.
Because it might be that one fellow is a lot worse off than the other worker. They're not all equal, are they? I mean, if they were all equal, there'd be no problem.
Precisely, but it comes down to a question of morality. You don't work for another pound. When I took my job at £3.10 a week, ASM in small parts, I come out the army, 47, that's what I got. 47, or £3.10 a week, and Diggs with a 25 bob all in. And the rest, I had the soap and the fags, you know. And the odd bit of our picture shoved round the bend, because I did the own cleaning. But I saved, and because I wanted to do the job and wanted to do it well, I got on, I got another rep fortnightly, and then after that I got monthly rep, you know, and I got a bit better. I did 7 years in the provinces before I came to London. And I think if you're prepared to do that kind of thing, you're doing it. What are you doing it for? You're not saying I want another pound all the time. You're saying I want to do the work better.
Yes, but
now, that was the kind of morality I was brought up with.
But
you don't do a job just for what you get. You do the job because you want to do it well.
Oh, but Kenneth, can I say I think that's crap? I mean, I'm sorry.
I've never been so insulted. Whose side are you on?
You see, it's all very well you saying that. It's all very well all of us here in jobs that are creative, where you can see if you go work, if you've got a talent, you can get to the top. And you can get, you know, handsome living. Now, you're not going to tell me that you are going to be compared with somebody who's sticking door handles on a car for 10 hours a day, 5 days a week, that he's not going to get frustrated, that he doesn't deserve an extra quid if he wants one. Of course his work ethic is money. It's got to be. He doesn't get the satisfaction from the job that we get. I mean...
That's true.
Of course it's true. You've talked... No, I'm sorry.
Of course
his
it's true.
His inference is the man who's sitting at the doorknobs on it's got a job that's monotonous and dreary.
Absolutely.
What do you think doing something night after night? I've done this play now, The Globe. I mean, I've said it so many times, I'm beginning to wonder what it means, you know. You keep on saying anything long enough and you begin to think you're daft, don't you?
I mean, that's the trouble. I mean, everybody does seem to think that our work is glamorous.
It's fabulous. Right? They're fabulously glamorous. Not at all. It's a simple business of self-discipline and going on night after night and doing it as well as you can. Right. And if I have to stick doorknobs on, and I've done it,
yes.
I've stuck doorknobs on, I've painted my own walls when I haven't got the money to employ a decorator, I'll do it because I like doing it, I want to do it well.
But the other difference is, Kenneth, that the guy who goes on strike is not earning your salary. He's not earning 400 or 500 quid a week.
What about the period I didn't have any success, and I spent, 7 years in the provinces bumming around? That wasn't very successful.
No, of course not. But there was always, because you backed your talent, because your talent went in an area where talent pays off in the end, then you had a horizon, you could see ahead.
Well, what are you asking for? A world where every single job leads to some marvellous end?
Yes.
Well, all jobs can't be like that.
Well, precisely. And that's the problem.
But nevertheless...
I mean, so therefore you must allow people their frustrations.
No, they must accept their limitations, surely.
We don't have
come on.
They must be allowed to...
That's a Superman argument.
It isn't. Voltaire said every man must dig in his own bit of garden. There wasn't much wrong with Voltaire's philosophy, was there?
No. Sir John, could we have a calm word? Because Kenneth and I are getting rather excited.
By the way, do you know what they say his last words were, Voltaire?
Yeah.
They said, but apparently a priest came and they said, you know, will you now make your peace and renounce the devil and all his works? And he said, oh, it's a bit late in the day to be making enemies.
Sir John, were you going to say something?
About... I've forgotten.
And I don't blame you at all. Poetry. Let's talk about poetry.
Some of his lines have absolutely reverberated in my head.
Yes.
We were talking about you the other day. You weren't there. And Maggie was quoting a thing of yours, which has always stayed in her head. What was that line you were saying?
The phone for the fish knives, Norman.
Poem.
Yes.
And I was saying, the one that always stays in my head is the prayer of the lady about the air raids. It says, Lord, keep beneath thy special care 149 Cadogan Square. Which I love. Mm.
Yes. And come friendly bombs and fall on Slough.
Yes, you shouldn't mention
all the trouble I got in.
Did you have trouble in there?
Yes, that was when I was a prep school master on 30 quid a term in Gerrard's Cross.
Really?
Yes, all in, of course, but yes. Still didn't leave you much for cigarettes.
No. But no harpic.
No.
And what kind of problem did it create? Did you...
Well, you can't libel a corporation, thank goodness. You can libel an individual, like the borough engineer or somebody like that, but not a conglomerate body. But they've always, they've been very nice, generous to me in Slough, considering I was about 19 when I wrote that, and I'm now, goodness knows how old, 65, nearly 66. Why it should be remembered, I can't think. In those days... Everyone was very horrified by the new tendencies of things coming. We could see the evil world of tall skyscrapers and nothingness,
yes.
We've been describing, arriving. And that was what the anger of that poem was about. And the lack of consideration for the individual as a separate person. Why I must go on for a second. Why I like actors very much. And is because they're givers, not takers.
Yes.
And it's the takers we're always fighting against. You have to spend your whole time every day doing that thing of being en rapport with the audience. Very exhausting.
Yes. What one poet called the eternal reciprocity of tears. You see, to understand about comedy is to understand that. Because the pathos, which has got to be inherent in a comedy performance, if you haven't got it, you haven't got any comedy. If they're not really basically sorry and really identifying with your situation. There's a poem by Hal Burton somewhere about, you know, Caesar must die in them. You know, their lives must be rehearsed, their deaths must pass.
Kenneth, we are sadly running out of time.
It's a disgrace. You should have much longer. I asked for over an hour last time. I was sandwiched in for a couple of minutes. It's a disgrace. It really is.
I tell you what, you don't have to make good use of those couple of minutes, though, don't you?